Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Phil Bernstein is the real host of today's talk. But he unfortunately couldn't be here today, so he stuck me, his poor summer intern, with the duty of introducing our speaker, Dan Tuccio. However, it's no big hardship. In fact, it's a great pleasure and honor for me to introduce him. Dan has been one of the prime movers and shakers in the database research community over the past decade or so. He's been doing groundbreaking work in semi-structured data since its earliest days. Among his more influential projects have been the XMLQL query language, the Silk Route XML relational publishing system, and the XML data compressor, which won the Best Paper Award at SIGMOD. Dan has particularly excelled at tackling sticky foundational issues in databases. For example, in his various papers on the XML type checking problem. I myself worked with Dan as a master's student at UW on the XML toolkit project, and indeed that project is the reason why I got turned on to database research and am here today giving this introduction. So lately, Dan and his student Nilesh Dalvi have turned their attention towards another area, that of probabilistic databases, which is the topic of his tutorial today. This is a fascinating area, and I'm sure Dan is going to have a lot of interesting things to say. So I'm looking forward to it very much. Without further ado, Dan Tuccio.
Thank you, TJ. I thank you for this great introduction. I didn't notice that you had such a long list in front of you. I would have stopped you immediately. I believe I'm here among friends. The reason I'm here to give this talk is twofold. One is, this is going to be a tutorial at SIGMOD, which is a main database conference, which is going to be next week in Baltimore. And the second reason is because I just enjoy coming here and giving a talk whenever I can find an excuse to do so. I should also say this tutorial is by Nilesh Dalvi, which is over there, and myself. And Nilesh is still a graduate student, although he soon will finish being a graduate student at the University of Washington. And the SIGMOD organizers, they said, no way we can accept a graduate student to talk during a tutorial. So I got stuck talking for 3 hours, and you got stuck with my strong Eastern European accent for the next 3 hours, instead of enjoying Nilesh's sweet jokes with a sweet Bombay accent. So today I'm going to talk about probabilistic databases and probabilistic answers to queries. Databases, as we know them today, are deterministic. And that means that an item either is in the database or it's not in the database. A tuple either is in the query answer or is not in the query answer. And this general paradigm applies not just to the relational data model, but to all data models that we have been using in database systems, relational, entity relationship, non-first normal form called NF2 hierarchical, XML. They all are deterministic. What is a probabilistic database? A probabilistic database is one in which an item belongs to the database with a certain probability. This is a probabilistic event. Or sometimes the database might be deterministic, but somehow the query is such that what it returns is a probabilistic set. So then a tuple is an answer to the query is a probabilistic event. And this paradigm can also be extrapolated to several data models. But for this talk, I'm going to restrict the discussion to just to the relational model. That highlights the important differences between the deterministic and probabilistic data. So we will be discussing two kinds of occurrences of probabilistic data today. One is when the database is deterministic, it's a standard database, but we formulate a query, And for some reason, the output is probabilistic. And the second scenario is when the database itself is probabilistic, and the query answers are also probabilistic. Okay, so this is very new, right? Well, not quite. Probabilistic databases have been around for a long time, and actually their underlying foundation, they have an even older history. We trace them back to Cavallo and Pitarelli in a VLDB paper from 1987. As you see, there have been several probabilistic database systems that have been proposed in the past. So why now? Why is it now the time to take another close look at probabilistic data? And I have two major reasons that will be the main themes, the two main themes of this tutorial. The first is that we are witnessing an application pool, and that's driven by the need to manage imprecisions in data. And the second is that there is a technology push. There are recent advances, and some are not that recent, on query processing techniques that would apply to data probabilistic database systems. And this tutorial is built on these two themes. So let me dwell a little bit on these. So the application pull. The problem here is that we need to manage imprecisions in data. I will give you several examples. The type of imprecisions are non-matching data values between databases, imprecise queries from the users, inconsistent data, and so on and so on. I will discuss about five or six examples. So we always strive to manage more types of imprecisions in the database system. And actually, philosophically, if you look at our field, it's a database research field. What has driven this field for the last 20 years is in good part due to the need to manage imprecisions. I believe that you can trace several distinct research areas in our community to the need to manage specific kind of imprecisions. Data mining is about finding imprecise facts about the data that hold statistically. Semi-structured data that originated from the need to manage imprecisions in the way the data is structured. Schema matching is a field that due to the fact that people are not very precise when they describe their schemas, so when you try to reconcile them, you don't know how to do it. Nearest neighbor search, and so on and so on. So the first theme of this tutorial is that a large class of imprecisions in data can be modeled with probabilities, that probabilistic databases form a unifying framework for modeling a large class of imprecisions. And the second theme is technology push. So here I have two messages. One is that processing probabilistic data is fundamentally more complex than other data models. We haven't witnessed this in the past. Previous novel successful data models, like the semi-structured data model, the hierarchical data model, extensions to the relational data model, they started from foundations that were essentially efficient. But in probabilistic databases, we start with something that is inherently complex, and I will show you the source of this complexity. However, there is a rich collection of techniques. Some of them are new, but some are quite old, and people don't necessarily connect them to probabilistic databases that can be used to, that can be put to work to implement efficiently probabilistic databases. So the second theme is we will identify the source of complexity in probabilistic databases and then present a snapshot of non-trivial results that hopefully will address these complexities. I'm also hoping to set an agenda for future research. So some notes on this tutorial. When we started looking at the literature on probabilistic databases and tried to follow references, it's huge. There is already a rich literature on probabilistic databases per se, but this is also connected to knowledge representation, to top k answers to probabilistic reasoning. Then we got fascinated by the theory of random graphs. This tutorial is not supposed to be a survey. So we left out many references. We tried to convey a certain message here, as opposed to trying to be complete. And we're planning to make all the references available in a separate document. Right now, it's not up to date, but we will put that on the web. And the tutorial will be made available on the web. And in order to view this, you need to download TextPoint. How many people have used TextPoint? It's beautiful. Don't miss it. And you actually won't be able to see the slides without TextPoint. So this is an overview of the tutorial. First, I want to give a pretty detailed overview of several applications of imprecise data, of imprecisions in data. And the reason I'm going to give such a broad overview is that the first theme of this tutorial is that all these can be served by unifying probabilistic data model. And then I'm going to give to define a probabilistic data model as a possible word semantics. This is going to be much shorter. Then we'll take a break. And the second part, will be more about techniques in probabilistic databases. Representation formalism, three results from theoretical foundations, and then three techniques and implementations that are related to probabilistic database systems. Then I will summarize and enumerate three challenges. So applications for managing imprecisions in data. There are five that I'm going to mention. Let me go to the first one. The first one is ranking query answers. So we have a standard database. We ask a SQL query. But what we get back is not a set, but it's a ranked list of tuples. Why do we do this? I will show you several reasons why people are interested in getting ranked list of answers as opposed to a set. And users are often interested in seeing only the top scoring tuples as opposed to all of them. So the first problem actually is from a beautiful paper which was written here by Surajit and others. It's a CIDR 2003 paper. It's the empty answers problem. And I took the liberty to modify the query a little bit. Imagine trying to find a house in Seattle. So you're quite picky when you first move to Seattle, as we did 4 years ago. So I would like 4 bedrooms. I'd like a craftsman style. They're beautiful. I'd like to live in View Ridge. That at least I managed to do. And I'd like to pay under $400,000. And you ask this query, run it on your database, and get nothing. Good luck. So what people do, they move to Baltimore, where there is a SigMod conference. So what do people do here at Microsoft Research? They rank queries. So they represent a query over a table. They extract all the constants in these conditions, and they represent the query as a vector. And now every tuple in the table is also a vector. So instead of having a perfect match, they compute the TF-IDF similarity between these two. And this results in a score. And then they just sort the tuples according to this score.
What is TF-IDF?
OK. So I had about four slides on that, but it's far away from probabilistic databases. This is the standard technique in information retrieval. It stands for term frequency, inverse document frequency. It's a very simple idea. We try to come up with a number that represents how close these two vectors are. We view them as sets, and we compute the term frequency, so you compute how many common things there are, but at the same time we divide every time we have a match, we have a count here, we divide by how many times this term, this whatever the common term is, occurs in the entire table, in the entire collection. The intuition is that if it occurs often, then it's not a very important term. If it occurs unfrequently and we have a match, that's a good match. Okay, so that was ranking queries from a single table. What can you do, however, if you want to ask more complex queries and still rank the answers? And I try to come up here with an example. I give up trying to spend under 400K on a house. I'm willing to spend 600K. But then I would like to get a good deal. By a good deal, I mean I want in any neighborhood to get a house that's kind of unique. So here is how I write this in a query where I can express these similarity predicates explicitly. So here I'm also looking for houses. They should have four bedrooms, approximately. They should be craftsmen. They should be around 600K. However, there should not exist in the same neighborhood another house like that, except this one. So here, the similarity predicates are written explicitly in the SQL query. And we expect the answers to also be ranked. Sometimes it's not clear if the listing is unique or not. But the question is, how do you take these scores and combine them into a score for the global answers that the query returns? And it's not clear how to do this in an ad hoc fashion. However, it turns out that the natural model to do this is to use probabilistic databases. And then there is a very simple and intuitive semantics for the answer to this query. So yet another twist to our ranking queries in to ranking SQL queries. What kind of similarities predicates have people used? String edit distances, TF IDF scores, we saw that. Ontology distances. For instance, you can use let me go here. Semantic similarity. We actually try to do this. WordNet is a open source dictionary that offers an ontology of the entire English language. So you can compare two words that are syntactically quite different based on how close they are in meaning by having a function call to WordNet. And of course, SoundDex. All these are possible choices for similarity predicates that one can use in SQL. What I'm interested in is how to combine these scores and how to evaluate complex SQL queries that have several, where there are multiple occurrences of similarity predicates. More about queries to databases that returned sorted answers, ranked list of tuples. Keyword searches and databases. So now we give up on SQL queries. The assumption is that the user does not know the schema. Still, the users would like to search in the database like they search on the web by just typing keywords. And the way the systems that are described in the literature do this is that they try to find every word in all the tables in the database, and then they need to find some way to join these words in order to make sense of them together. So let me show you an example. So suppose we have the schema. It's an ER schema. This is a notation we use in class. It has nothing to do with what is used in industry, unfortunately, but this is what we use for ER diagrams. We have papers, we have conferences, and we have people, person. And of course, papers are in conferences, a many-one relationship. Each conference has an editor, and persons and papers, they are under this many-many relationship author. I would like to find out. I'm throwing this keyword search to the system, Abitabul and Vidom. Both are very well known and very senior database researchers. They must have something in common. What can there be? Well, here is what Christidis and Papa Constantino do. They construct these tuple trees. For example, they say, we found arbitrable and vidom in person, and they are authors to the same common paper. Or they are not authors of the same paper, but the two papers they authored appear in the same conference. Now, obviously, if you look at this, this answer should be less important to the user than the previous answer. Somehow, it's less meaningful. And here is my favorite one. So Abitabul wrote a paper in a conference which was chaired by Widom. This year, Jennifer Widom is a PC chair. And actually, I still haven't checked whether Serge Abitabul has a paper in Sigmod or not. But hopefully, he will be in the audience and correct me if I'm wrong. Yet another way to rank query answers, preference SQL. There are two approaches to preference languages in SQL. One, the qualitative approach does not rank answers, but instead uses apparatus semantics. The second one, a quantitative approach, which is described in Fagan, I should have, in Fagan and Wimmers, that does result in query answer, in query ranking. So what I have shown you are several different applications, in fact, where we have a deterministic database, and we run a query, which is either a SQL query or a SQL query with similarity predicates or a set of keywords. And what we get back is a ranked list of tuples. What kind of imprecisions do these address? And I try to identify three imprecisions. Either the user doesn't understand the data. He doesn't know exactly how to formulate the predicates. Or he has limited understanding of the schema. So we try to let him just type in keywords. Or the user may have personal preferences. He may have his own preferences how to rank the answers. So this is nice, and most of these systems have been built without probabilities in mind. What would a probabilistic approach bring us? First of all, it will bring a principal semantics for complex queries. I don't think it will help in a direct way the single table ranking systems that use IDF and TF-IDF similarity scores. But for complex queries, the only principal semantics I'm aware of is that based on probabilities. And importantly, it would integrate well with the other kinds of imprecisions that I'm going to show you next. The second kind of class of applications is built around record linkage. This is a huge field. It's mostly popular in knowledge representation data and data mining, but there is also a subarea in databases that does record linkage. The problem is we are given a large collection of records, or maybe two collections of records, and we would like to identify common objects. We want to find out if two records are the same. And this is not obvious because there might be misspellings, there might be different representations of addresses because of all sorts of practical reasons. There are three scenarios. Either we have two relations, and we would like to join them or merge them and find out which object matches what one. Or we have a single collection, and it's kind of dirty. We would like to eliminate duplicates. Or there might be a reference table. We know that's clean and correct, and now we get incoming tuples, and they are dirty, and we would like to match them against the reference table. So there is a very rich literature on record linkage, and I felt the need to at least mention this buzzword. All the techniques in record linkage, if you're not familiar with the area, they are classified into two important categories: those that follow the Fellegi-Sundor model and those that don't follow this model. It's essentially, this is This is the way they define themselves. What is the Feligman-Sunter model? It's a very old paper from 1969 that essentially set the model for doing record linkage. It's a probabilistic framework. We have two sets of records. It's important to keep in mind that they are records. And the goal is to classify the set of pairs into three classes: matches, non-matches — there are certain non-matches — and uncertain. The uncertain ones will be processed by hand. So the first principle in the Feligman-Sunter model is that it's a partition on the Cartesian product of A and B. The details on how they do this, I had a hard time putting this in a slide. Let me try to give you the highlights. It's not going to, you're not going to understand the model completely. The crucial idea is that these are records, the A's and B's. So the model assumes that you compare the records component-wise. And when you compare these, you get some similarity scores, which are numbers in 0 or 1. This is called the comparison vector. It's a set of vectors, and think of them as scores in 0, 1. And the model assumes that you have this set, gamma, of all possible comparison vectors, all possible similarity scores that you can get. And now the model asks the question, what is a good mapping from gamma, from the set of these possible outcomes between similarities, into match, uncertain, or non-match, such that certain probabilities are optimized? And explaining what exactly is optimized will take me another three slides, so I'm going to skip that. What is important for us here is that in this model, every pair is compared and is judged in a probabilistic way. The output is the probabilistic. However, this linkage rule makes a deterministic choice, whether it's going to be a match, a non-match, or is uncertain. And one of the main criticisms of this model is that this deterministic choice is based on two parameters that you have to choose, and it's not clear how to choose them. So people discuss non-Feligman-Sunter approaches. I've seen the term deterministic linkage used for them. They're actually much easier to understand. One way to do this is to normalize the records. You want to see if two records that are kind of similar but not identical are the same. Try to normalize them and then compare them for equality. This works for some domains, for instance, addresses. You might have a program that normalizes addresses. It's very fast when it works. But normalization also loses information, so sometimes it doesn't work. Okay, yes?
So what is normalization? You mean there's a canonical representation?
Yeah, a canonical representation.
So this is only when there is such a canonical representation?
Right. It only works in application when you have such a canonical representation exists. So for our purpose, we view record linkage as a process that gives us some approximate matches between objects. How are these approximate matches used today? They are used almost exclusively in data cleaning, in expensive data cleaning operations, or ETL. And there is a rich literature on how to do this, and I just picked this from the database literature. But the important message here is that, first of all, it's expensive. And second, you have to make some deterministic choices at some point. There is one other application that's in the literature that I find much more fascinating. And this is a system called WIRL by William Cohen, described in the SIGMOD 98 paper. It's not exactly based on record linkage, but it's based on the same general idea, that we have two sets, and we are comparing pairs of elements in these two sets based on similarity. Here is what WIRL does. It's a database system. It uses tables, but it allows you to write a similarity predicate between the attributes and the table. And he assumes that all these attributes are strings. Moreover, he collects these tables from the web. So the fact that the elements do not match, that the strings don't match, is real. Different companies have different spellings and different sources. So when they're trying to join them, they will not join. Here is an example taken right from his paper on how to use will. This is data log notation. How many people have seen data log before? About half. So it's an alternative notation to SQL that's sometimes more convenient to convey an idea. Here we have three tables, P, Q, and R. And we join them. P is about companies and industries, Q about companies and websites, R about industry and analysis. And they come from three different sources from the web. So now we would like to join them. So we need to find common companies, and we do this using a similarity predicate. And we need to match these two industries, again, with a similarity predicate. So we get a list of tuples. We need to decide what score we give to every tuple in the result. And the decision in Weird is that we just multiply the scores returned by these two similarity predicates. So it's a multiplication. Now, thinking of more complex database queries, what happens if you also have a projection, which implies duplicate elimination? So now you need to combine a set of tuples, each of them with a score, into a single tuple with a single score. And what Weir does is it applies a formula that assumes independence between these scores. It's like a probabilistic it's like a formula computing a probability, but assuming independence. And this, as I will show you later, is quite an ad hoc decision. Because it turns out that the answer depends on the query plan. It depends on the order in which we do the joins and the projections. Two different plans that normally have the same meaning will turn out to have different answer, will turn out to return different scores. So that was the second class of applications, record linkage. What kind of imprecisions do these address? I think it's pretty obvious. They address the fact that the same data item, the same real-life data items, are represented differently in different sources, in different databases, because of misspellings, because of lack of canonical representation, and so on. Record linkage algorithms are used today in expensive data cleaning tasks. What would a probabilistic model help us to do? It will allow us to do cheaper data cleaning or to use in a cheaper way the result of a record linkage algorithm. We could use it on the fly. We could feed its results directly into the query processor without going through a human. So it's cheaper and it's on the fly. However, it also needs a more sophisticated probabilistic model. It needs to understand the difference between the case when there are when we eliminate duplicates in a single collection, and the case when we match a relation to a reference table, or the case when we just match two tables, both of which might contain duplicates. These turn into different correlations between the probabilistic tuples. So we need a powerful probabilistic model in order to cope with these distinctions. The third class of application, this is perhaps less well known. It's about quality and data integration. And I think it was initiated by Florescu, Kohler, and Levy in a VLDB 1997 paper. So Alon Levy, who now is called Alon Halevy, He pioneered this style of data integration called localist view that allows you to integrate hundreds or thousands of data sources by defining a single global view and then expressing all these data sources in terms of views as in terms of queries over the global schema. And then he asked the following question. What happens if these different sources overlap or if some of them are incomplete or if some of them are even contradictory? And in this early paper, they analyze a problem in terms of ontologies. What I'm going to show you today is this approach by Bendelsohn and Mihaila, which applies the same idea to queries as opposed to ontologies. Okay, so let me just show you first, and then I'll show you what the applications are. So in their paper, Mendelsohn and Mihaila talk about the global historical climatology network. I don't think they actually integrated it. I think they just used it as an example. But it's an intriguing example. Apparently, there are thousands of different sources, data sources, each of them storing climatic data. Temperature measurements, precipitation measurements, pressure measurements. And there are, how many? About 15,000 of them. And some of them hold very old data, dating back to 1697. Some of them are probably newer data. Obviously, they are not correct, not all correct. Some are better than others. Some might have overlapping information. So they define the soundness of a data source to be the fraction of items that are correct according to the specification in the data integration system. And the completeness is what fractions of items that is supposed to cover it actually contains. Let me show you an example. So here is how you would define a data integration system in the local SVU framework. You start by defining a global schema. You say, these are the two tables I would like to see, nothing else, not these 15,000 different data sources. I would like to see a temperature table and a station table. And now you have to go through 15,000 different sources, and that each of them analyze it and see how it relates to this global schema. For example, V1 may contain, what does it contain here? A station, the latitude, the longitude, and C is probably some measurement. The next station, this will be clearer, the next source contains temperature measurements. They are only in Canada, and they are after 1900, and so on. And you have to go all the way to source number 8756. So that was the localist view data integration paradigm. Now, here is how we define soundness and completeness. Let's take this example. So according to this declarative specification, to this description, V2 should contain measurements in Canada after 1900. But maybe it doesn't contain all of them. If we define the completeness to be at least 40%, it means that this source, as far as we know, contains 40% of all these measurements. And soundness will say that 70% of what it contains actually are correct measurements. Yeah, that's we might not trust. So now the goal is, in this paper, the goal is, given a query, compute for each of its answers the confidence level. How certain are we on the answer that we are returning? In the other paper by Florescu and Levy and Kohler, the goal was to decide in which order to query the sources. You try to query first the sources that are more likely to contain relevant information. So in this example, you would ask a query over the global schema, and what you get back is a set of answers with a confidence level. So that was quality and data integration. What type of imprecisions do these applications address? They address a very real source of imprecision. The fact that different data sources that we would like to integrate are overlapping, are sometimes inconsistent, are often incomplete. Hence, the data itself is probabilistic. Moreover, the query answers are also probabilistic. They just carry this probability through. Both systems that we found in the literature already use a probabilistic model. But the point here is that they need a very complex probabilistic space. The probabilistic model needs to be complicated. And none of them actually solves the query processing problem. They're still in infancy. OK, the fourth class of applications, inconsistent data, or also called constraint violations. The idea here is you have a database, and it is supposed to satisfy certain constraints, but bad luck. It doesn't satisfy the constraints it's supposed to satisfy. And here you should stand up and shout at me, how can this be? If you write a constraint in SQL, it will just enforce it for you. It will never allow you to ever insert data that violates that constraint. It will never allow you to insert a duplicate key. True, but there are lots of scenarios in which this can happen. For example, when you integrate data from multiple sources, every person is supposed to have a single address. But it's quite common that you get the same information about the same person from different sources. He's listed under different addresses. Or sometimes you just don't enforce the integrity constraints. You would like to enforce them later, and then, of course, it's too late. Or there might be temporary inconsistencies. So what the research community has done here, of course, in industry, what you do in this case, you do an expensive data cleaning operation. What researchers would like to do, because they don't have money, they would like to do this automatically. They would like the system to accept a query and to look at the data and give you a consistent answer from the data. And that was a program essentially pushed by Bertozzi and Chomicki. Let me show you how this works. Here is an example of a database. It's about graduating students, Miklau, Dalvi, Balazinska, and Miklau. The name is supposed to be a key, but because we got this data from different sources, it's not a key. Miklau, I happen to know this domain. He is my student. He graduates this year, and he moves from UW to UMass. He got a position at UMass. Balazinska moves the other way around. She graduates from MIT. She comes to us, to UW. She's going to be our new database faculty. Only poor Nilesh stays here forever and ever until he will finish his PhD on probabilistic databases. So now you would ask a query like, find all people in the state of Washington. The approach promoted by Bertozzi and Chomicki is the following. Look at this data, try to repair it. You repair it by deleting tuples. You consider only the minimal repairs. Repair. And you return only those answers that are certain in every single repair. No matter how you repair it, Nilesh is not going away. He's stuck here. But every other person, like Balazinska, depending on how you repair it, she may not be in the state of Washington. If you try to find all people in the state of Massachusetts, none of them will be in all possible repairs. So this is a state of the art of dealing with inconsistent data based on repairs. It's great. It has perfect precision. Everything it returns is correct. But it has a rather low recall. And what we are advocating is to use an alternative probabilistic approach. So here we would say, whenever you find a conflict, just decrease its probability. So Miklau, we're not sure where he is right now. He's supposed to write his thesis. But we just say that we have confidence of 50% that either of these two tuples is correct. So now the answers to the previous queries are richer. We get more answers. We just tell the user that the probability here is less than one. And of course, we rank these answers based on their probability. So lower precision, but better recall. Keys are not the only kind of constraints. There are all sorts of constraints that you can imagine can be handled this way. So let me just summarize inconsistent data. They also addressed a form of imprecision. And that form is that the data that often comes from different sources is contradictory. It's uncertain. And arguably, because it's uncertain, I would say it's also probabilistic. And of course, the query answers are also probabilistic. If we had a probabilistic database, that would be great. In this case, we immediately get an improvement. We get a better recall. Such a system, however, needs to be able to support disjoint tuple events. It must be able to understand that either this or that is in the database. It cannot both be in the database. The fifth class of application, and this is totally different from the others. It's about information disclosure. Here the goal is not to get data, to get information, to answer queries, but it's more to protect data, to make sure that certain secret queries are not leaked. And the way this is modeled is that we denote with S the sensitive piece of data. Think of it as a query, which is a Boolean query. It's about a particular person. This might be the query, is Mary Johnson in the database and does she have flu? Is Mary Johnson with flu in the database? Does there exist a tuple in the database called Mary Johnson with flu? We also denote with V what we want to give. And this can have several facets. For example, in privacy preserving data mining, V would be the anonymized transactions. In data exchange, V would be a standard view. And you're still worry about if a secret query is leaked or not. In key anonymization, if you're familiar with this field, V would be the key anonymous table, where you anonymize certain fields to make the table key anonymous. And in all cases, S is just some atomic fact that remains private. So the database community has become recently quite interested in studying information disclosure. And I'm going to show you three definitions that have been proposed. It's still an infancy, this field. All definitions relate to probabilities. One is a probability of S without knowing anything. There is a certain probability that Mary Johnson has flu. I don't know who Mary Johnson is, but I know that about 1% of the population has flu at every given moment. So Mary Johnson, for all I know, has flu with probability 0.01. However, if you give me the view, and that view is about your patients in your hospital, and you try to hide some data, but you didn't do a very good job, I may not be sure that Mary Johnson is inside, but I may have a much better guess. Maybe I see someone whose name is MJ and has flu. But not many people have their initials MJ. I can do the math, and maybe the probability turns out to be 20%. So analyzing information disclosure is a game between these two probabilities. The a priori probability, before I see the published data, and the a posteriori probability, after I see the published data. And there have been three definitions proposed in the literature. One is a row one, row two privacy breach. So here we say that something is bad. If the a priori probability was low, less than row one, But the a posteriori probability is big. It's greater than arrow 2. The second definition is perfect security. We say that things are perfect if these two probabilities are identical. It's kind of too strong. If they're identical, the row 1, row 2 breach can never happen. Because, well, these two can't be equal, since row 1 is less than row 2. And the one actually I believe in most is this one, what we call practical security, where we act because here we don't ask you to look at the a priori probability. I don't know how to quantify what the attacker knows about Mary Johnson having flu or not. If that's 1% or 0.1% or 0.01%. I have no clue how to think about this. All I know is that that probability better be low. It can't be high. If it's high, then I'm trying to hide something that's common knowledge. So then I would analyze disclosure by doing this, by computing this probability, and then letting the domain size be big. And that's actually the way we hide data. We hide data when the domain size is big. If there are many possible people in the universe, then we can hide Mary Johnson among them. So that's how it works. And when we do this, we also have to assume, and this is a very practical assumption, that the database size remains fixed. Because if the database size were to grow with the domain size, then, well, Mary Johnson can still be there with high probability. And that's not realistic. So a summary on information disclosure. Is this a form of imprecision in data? And I would argue that, yes, information disclosure is a form of imprecision. It's the adversary uncertainty about the private data. What might strike you is that this is the only type of good imprecision. All the others are bad, we want to get rid of them. That's the only one we like. The techniques used here, the only good ones I know are probabilistic methods. The database community has not invented them. They have been introduced by Shannon in 1949. One thing to remember is that in order to do this kind of analysis, we need to be able to compute conditional probabilities. That's, again, on the wish list for probabilistic databases, conditional probabilities. And there is another thought that I would like to share with you. It's this duality. There is this very simple connection between answering queries in the presence of uncertainties, answering queries over a probabilistic database, and reasoning about information disclosure, protecting secrets. In answering queries, we want high probabilities. We want to look at the tuples whose probability is high. When we worry about information disclosure, we want to check that the probabilities are low. We want to make sure that all our secrets will have low probability. So two apparently disparate areas, they are kind of connected at a very fundamental level. Okay, and what this requires is a very rich probabilistic model. Let me skip over this. This essentially ends my first part on applications. I have a last slide on other applications that I think address other kind of imprecisions in data. Data lineage and TRIO, this is a new probabilistic database system developed at Stanford. They want to trace the origin and the way every data item has been modified and then assign to it a probability. Sensor data, a very rich research area. Here, the source of uncertainty should be pretty straightforward. Measurements have errors. And a second way why probabilities are introduced is perhaps less obvious in this BLDB 2004 paper. They say that even making a measurement is expensive. When you have these tiny mods, they have a battery. When you send them a signal to give you a measurement, that costs a little bit of the battery. So if you had a probabilistic model that will tell you what the temperature might be without having to spend your battery life, then better returns that estimated temperature with some lower confidence And here we are. We are back to probabilistic data. And then a third class of applications, and it goes on and on. Personal information management. This is about a system that would manage your personal files. And if you wonder what is imprecise about these files, I don't know about your files, but my files are pretty imprecise. I could use a probabilistic system. So this is the end of the first part. Let me just summarize. What I've shown you are a few quite disparate applications. They have almost nothing to do with each other. But what they share in common is that either the query answer is ranked, is imprecise, or has some score to it, and sometimes even the database is probabilistic. And we argue for the need for a common probabilistic model. And why? The main benefit from having a common probabilistic model to handle all types of imprecisions in data is that we would have a uniform approach to most of these imprecisions. We can unify them. And there are other benefits that are specific to each application. Sometimes they are bigger, sometimes they are smaller. We can manage more complex queries when we rank SQL answers. We can have cheaper solutions to data cleaning by doing on-the-fly record linkage. We could have better recall when we deal with constraint violations. Okay, any questions about part one? Yes?
There were these two cases. In one case, you wanted to be close to one. In another case, you wanted to be close to zero.
Yes.
I wonder how principal the difference is, because instead of speaking about the probability of giving away a secret, which is, should be close to zero, you can speak about the probability of keeping the secret, which should be close to one. So is there something deeper between differentiating the two?
So ultimately, you need different algorithms and different systems when you deal with them. But they do share some common concepts and techniques. And that's all I know about this commonality. But I did find it striking when I realized that there is this commonality. We can talk offline more. I can show you where I think this commonality is. Okay, so the second part in the next, hopefully, 20-25 minutes, will be on a probabilistic data model. And I warn you, this is not really a model. It's more a probabilistic semantics. And the semantics is a possible words semantics, or the possible words model. And I will show you the semantics. I keep calling it a model. And I will show to you that every query has a very elegant and intuitive semantics in this model. So here is a possible words model. I need definitions. First of all, every domain, every attribute domain in our database schema is finite. I hope you agree with my statement. I wrote here the math. Even if your attribute is varchar of 55, it only has 2 to the power of 440 values. But it's finite. So if you have a relational schema like employee with these attributes, then the number of tuples it can contain is finite. It's just as big. Therefore, the number of instances it can contain is just as big. I hope you appreciate my PowerPoint slides here. This is a double exponential. And even if you have multiple tables, this is your database schema, the number of instances is big, but it's finite. So this justifies introducing this notation. Instances, these are all the possible instances that you can build on your database schema. And now I can define a probabilistic database. It's just a probability distribution on this set. It means I don't know which instance it is. Each of them has some probability. And when you give this function, you have to make sure that it adds up to 1. Because every separate instance is a different probabilistic event. And I will use either PR, which is a probability distribution, but I will also use I. We tend to use I for instances, so I'm going to use I superscript P to think of it as it's like an instance. It's just probabilistic. So this is called the possible word semantics. And the set of instances, of deterministic instances, where the probability is non-zero, are called the possible words. Another way to think about this is that maybe the set of possible words is not that big. So you would just enumerate the set of possible words, and then you would give the probability for each of them. Obviously, you won't do this in practice. That's just the model, the mathematical model. Let me give an example. Here are four possible words. All are instances of this table, customer, address, and product. And I just chose arbitrary probabilities here, 1/3, 1/12, 1/12. But you have to make sure that they add up to 1. So if there is any error, please let me know. This is 1/6 plus 1/3 is 1/2. Yep, they add up to 1. So the possible words are 4. And here are their probabilities. OK, this is the definition of a probabilistic database. Now let me have a brief discussion about tuple correlation. We think of tuples as events. A single tuple is the event that t belongs to I when I is chosen at random. The probability of this event is obtained as a sum of the probabilities of all the possible words that contain that tuple. Two tuples together form an event. When that's the event, something went wrong here. That's the event that database at random contains both tuples. And now, yes?
You may have one question about a previous slide.
You said these were finite. How do you know how many records are in a... Like, couldn't records go on forever inside the table?
Okay, so if records could go on forever, they couldn't. In this mathematical model, we don't allow duplicates.
So what is the limit?
The limit is the number of possible tuples you can have, which is derived from the number of possible values you can have in the in the domain.
Self-declared limit?
It's implicit in the domain. Let's see.
For this example, what would be the limit of the number of records you could have?
Yeah, so let's look at this example. To get to that limit, we have to decide on the type of customer. Let's say that's varchar of 55. And address is varchar of 100. And product is...
Oh, I see. So a duplicate record is not considered valid.
Record is not considered valid. And actually, this is...
But in the case... For example, if this were products that John bought, he bought 5 cameras, wouldn't that be 5 valid records? Or you would have something else that disambiguates. I see.
We want to stick to set semantics. So we will not allow duplicate tuples in the same table. And to disambiguate, you would have to introduce another.
Or
an arbitrary key identifier.
Okay, and a finite number of those. Okay.
Yes.
It's not clear in the mathematical model why it should have finite many elements.
Why it should have finite many elements?
Because probabilities live also in infinite domains as well.
Probability is true in the infinite domain, but database theoreticians, I don't think they master the infinite.
So you just want to avoid the integrals, right?
We want to avoid the infinite domain, yes. And that's actually all we care about in practice. Yes.
Something bad is going to happen when it comes time to talking about complexity. Simply fix the finite. And we do everything in constant time.
No. Okay. The complexity will always be in terms of some specification, some representation. And that's much, much smaller. OK, so I want to talk about tuple correlations. And I want to dispel that doubt that you might have, that maybe this is a simplistic definition, that it's tuple independent. It's not. It allows you arbitrary correlations between tuples. Let me remind you what correlations are. Let's start with this in the middle. Two tuples are called independent if the probability of them occurring together is equal to their product. This is standard definition in probability theory. They can be negatively correlated, or they can be completely disjoint if they never occur in the same possible world. Or they can be positively correlated. Or at the extremes, they can be identical. They occur in exactly the same possible world. And I use these symbols. I'm not sure they're very inspired to represent tuples. So let's look at the previous example. For example, John, being in Seattle and buying Gizmo and buying a camera, they are identical probabilistic events because these two tuples, they occur in the same possible worlds, and it's never the case that one occurs and the other doesn't. These two tuples are positively correlated. They do occur sometimes separately. For example, Seattle camera also occurs here, but the probability where they occur together, it's bigger than whatever when they occur separately. I actually didn't do the math very carefully, but I think they are positively correlated. Here, something again obvious to see, or maybe here. Let's look at these two. These are disjoint events, because John in Seattle and John in Boston never occur together. I should actually disclose a big secret to you. This this probabilistic instance is meant to model a functional dependency, that every customer has a single address. So therefore, John is either in Seattle or in Boston. And these two tuples, they are disjoint probabilistic events. The message I want to convey is that possible worlds is a very powerful model. It's not restricted to independent probabilistic events. Good. So we have this model. It's not standard probability theory. Now we take a query. We have a SQL query. What does it mean on a probabilistic database? And there are actually two different interpretations. We found both of them in the literature, so we convey both of them to you. The first semantics is a possible answers. The names are not standard. We came up with this classification. So here you interpret the query as returning different possible sets of answers, and each answer set has a probability. The answer set A has a probability which is the sum of all probabilities of those possible words on which the answer is precisely A. The second is you just care about tuples, and you say that the probability of a tuple is the sum of the probability of those in possible words on which the query returns that tuple. It will be much clearer on an example. Let's look here. It's more or less the same database as before. It's not exactly. I tweaked it to get more interesting answers. The query is this. Find all products that have been bought by both John and Sue. And as you can see here, I'm careful to use set semantics because the entire model is based on set semantics. We didn't want to get into the issues. Actually, none of the data of the probabilistic database systems I'm aware of gets into the issues of duplicates. So what does this mean? One way to interpret this is using the possible answer semantics. You examine what kind of answers you can get. You can get both Gizmo and camera. This happens in I1. John and Sue both bought Gizmo and both bought camera. You can get just Gizmo without camera, and this happens in I2. Or you can get just camera, and this happens in I3 and I4. You never get the empty set in this example. So the empty set is not a possible answer. Or you can just look at the possible tuples you can get. Camera, you get in I1, 3, and 4. So its probability would be 11, 12. And Gizmo, you get in 1 and 2. Its probability is 5, 12. Now, if you were to implement such a system, I would argue it's much easier to return this to the user. I would know how to, you don't agree.
It discloses some information, right?
It loses information, I agree. So there is a trade-off between how precise we want to be and how easy it is to design an interface. Maybe I was too bold saying that I would. This is a favorite one. I agree, there are trade-offs. If you return this to the user, this conveys more information about the correlation between gizmo and camera, while this one loses that information. But I would know how to, I would at least know how to present this on the screen. Let me say it this way. I don't know how to present this on the screen. So this ends the second part. And after I summarize, we can take a break. So let me summarize on the possible word semantics. This is a very powerful model. It can model any type of correlations. However, it's the small problem it has, it's not a model. We have no clue at this point how to start writing down these probability distribution on all possible instances. This is something that I'm going to discuss at the beginning of the second part after the break. But I warn you, I think this is the major open research problem in probabilistic databases, to come up with a good representation language for probabilistic databases. And the second group of thoughts I have is a group of comments is about query semantics. The important message is that every SQL query, as long as it has a set semantics, also has a natural semantics on probabilistic data. Remember that complicated existential query that we had in the beginning? We had no clue what semantics to give it. Now it's there. We know exactly what semantics to give it once we interpret the predicates as probabilities, and I will show you this. I will show you how to do this in the second part. So I argue this is a very intuitive semantics, and just the simplicity of the semantics makes the possible words model worthwhile. There are two variations to query semantics. Both appear in the literature, and let me summarize them. Possible answers. This is very precise. He was right. Under possible answers, you do not lose information. Moreover, it can be used to compose queries. If you had a magic way to represent these possible answers, then you can store them as a view and then later query them. It's compositional. But at least, well, what do I know about query, about user interfaces? But to me, a user interface for a set of possible answers looks cumbersome. The possible tuple semantics, they are less precise, but they are simpler. And I would argue they're sufficient for most apps. They cannot be used to compose queries because you lose information. And this is where I think it's a good place to stop. If you have any questions at this point. And the second part, just in case you're deciding whether to stay or not, I'm going to talk about four parts, actually, after the break. Representation formalist. This will be quite detailed. It will also leave you a little bit unsatisfied, because there is no good one. I will show you what people have done in the literature, their pluses and minuses, and how they fit together. But I don't think there is a good one. And then we'll talk about foundations. I have three interesting stories from theory to tell you. One is about random graphs, the evolution of random graphs, which I think a few people know here. I hope I will have time to show it to you. It's fascinating. If you've never seen a random graph evolving, now is the time to see it. And then I have three snapshots of algorithms. They're again from all over. And they together kind of give you the impression that there is hope that we can evaluate queries on probabilistic databases efficiently. So thank you for staying. I hope to see most of you after the break. And let's take a break. Welcome, everyone, to the second part of the tutorial on probabilistic databases. And this second half, we should call it second half, we will talk about representation formalists. some free snapshots of interesting theoretical results that have to deal with probabilistic databases, three snapshots of algorithm and implementation techniques, and then three major challenges. So let me start with representation formalism. So the problem is we cannot work with a possible world, with a possible word semantics per se. To represent a database just using the possible word semantics, what would we need to do? We would need to enumerate all possible words, use a huge amount of space, and then write down next to each of them its probability. It doesn't work this way. We need some more clever ways to do this. So unfortunately, there is no universal good kind of convincing way to do this. There have been several formalisms that have been proposed, and my goal is to convey them to you. Each of them has some weaknesses, and each of them solves a certain trade-off in one way or another. We believe that this is the main open problem in probabilistic databases, to define a good useful formalism for representing probabilistic databases. So the ones I'm going to describe to you, unfortunately, they don't have good names. We came up with these names. Are tuple-independent databases, intentional databases. This is a standard name. Tuple-disjointed independent, statistic-based distribution. Okay, let me just go on, and you'll see what I mean. But before I start presenting them, here is how we are going to evaluate them and judge them. We are going to look, first of all, at the expressive power of that formalism. What kind of possible words can you represent in that formalism? And what kind of probability distribution on these words? Some will be weaker, some will be stronger. A complete representation formalism would be one in which you can represent all possible probabilistic databases. The second question we are going to address is how does this interact with a query language? Is it closed under the query language composition? If we start with a probabilistic database in that representation and apply a query and retain its possible answers, are these possible answers still expressible in the formalism? If yes, then we call that formalism closed. Okay, so I'm going to start with the simplest one, which are the tuple-independent databases. But let me first give you a definition. What does tuple-independent mean? You probably have already a good feeling. It means it's a probability distribution in which all the tuples are independent. Another way to look at it is that a tuple-independent probabilistic database is given by a function on the tuples. So I convinced you earlier that the number of tuples is finite, because I had to convince you that the number of instances is finite. The number of tuples is one exponential smaller in size. So let me denote with tup the number of tuples. And then the instances would be the subset, the power set of the tuples, even bigger. Let's assume that we have a function that associates to each tuple a number, and 0 and 1. That's a probability. There are no restrictions. They don't have to add up to 1, because these will be interpreted as independent events, not disjoint events. A tuple-independent probabilistic database is one for which the probability is given by this product, the product of all tuple probabilities in the database, and one minus the product of 1 minus the probabilities of the tuples not in database. It's a very simple definition. So we can take that and easily transform this into a very simple specification formalism. And I have no clue how to call it. Let's call it extensional tuple independent formalism. It's very simple. Take any SQL instance. Just make sure that every tuple has an attribute, PR. That's a number between 0 and 1. It gives its probability. It's the simplest kind of representation you can think of. Let's look closely at one example. Here is an instance with 3 tuples. And next to each tuple, I wrote a probability. that would be an, how do we call it, extensional tuple independent instance. But now we need to make sure that we understand how this is interpreted as a possible word semantics. So what is the probability distribution on all possible words that this representation defines? Well, this is what it defines. It defines all possible subsets of these tuples, and each such subset has a certain probability. Let's start with one. So I decided to take John in Seattle and Sue in Boston, but not Fred in Boston. The probability of this instance is P1, because John is in, P2, because Sue is in, and 1 minus is P3, because Fred is out. All the other tuples in the universe have probability 0. So you can imagine here multiplying with 1 minus 0 many, many times. Another instance is when we have all 3 tuples, and its probability is P1, P2, P3. And then there are many other instances. In fact, there are exactly 8 in this case, and these are exactly the possible words. Any other instance will have probability 0. And here are its probabilities. Now, when you add up these probabilities, what do you expect to get? Once I gave a talk, and people weren't convinced. In fact, it turns out that if you add these up, you get the probability 1, which is good. It means that this is a probability distribution on instances. So this would be a specification formalism. I understand how to store this in a database, just store these probabilities. This is its semantics. This is its meaning. Let me give you an example. Remember the first application that we saw when we interpreted predicates as similarity predicates. Imagine a complex SQL query where somewhere nested, no matter how deeply inside in any subquery, we have this similarity predicate. It says the profession should be like scientist. For such a similarity predicate, I would use an ontology distance. You can use an ontology and figure out that a statistician is pretty close to a scientist, a musician is less so. The way to interpret such a SQL query on a deterministic database. I get into trouble with Jennifer Widom.
Her undergraduate is in music. No, I'm just kidding.
She doesn't like music?
No, her undergraduate degree is in music.
Sorry?
Her undergraduate degree is in music.
I see. Uh-huh. Okay. This is a good inspiration for my future joke, but I don't know yet what it will be. But thank you for the hint. And I may mention your name when I...
No.
Okay. To interpret this query, what we do, we just extract this similarity predicate, wherever it is, we take it away, and we apply it first on the database, and we obtain a probabilistic database. By simply computing the probabilistic score of each profession to be a scientist. And now we are left with another SQL query without this predicate, which we have to evaluate on a probabilistic database. And this is a simply tuple-independent probabilistic database. Let's see how query evaluation works on tuple-independent databases. It's so intuitive that it's worth going through this exercise. Here is a database with 2 tables, customers and purchases. And in purchases, we have a foreign key into customers. John bought, this John here bought 3 products. Somehow, we obtain some tuple probabilities for every single tuple, perhaps as a result of processing some similarity predicates. Now we're left with this query, which is a simple join query, followed by a projection and duplicate elimination. So the question is, what are the cities where there are customers who bought gadget? Let's see how to evaluate this query. We know it's semantics. It's according to the possible word semantics. Let's evaluate it in a more intuitive way, so we get a feeling of what query processing would involve. Which cities can there be? Well, there are only two cities in our database, so the possible answers can only be Seattle and Boston. All we have to do is to compute their probabilities. Let's look at Seattle here. In order for Seattle to participate, John must be in. So this must be multiplied with P1, because that's the probability of John being in. But in addition, he must join with one of these three tuples, and we really care about gadgets. So one of these two tuples must be in. One of Q2 or Q3 must be in. And if you remember your probabilities mass, that probability is 1 minus 1 minus Q2, 1 minus Q3. Is it clear why that's a formula? You think of what's the probability that none of them is in. But it's a product that neither is in. And therefore, at least one is in based on this probability. So bingo, we are done with the first tuple. That's its probability. Let's see the second one. So here we also have Boston. Boston may occur for two reasons. Let's look at the first reason. So its probability would be P2 times, same thing here. That would be 1 minus Q5, 1 minus Q6. But there is a second reason. Boston may appear because P3, come on, P3, times Q7. Either of them is sufficient for Boston to be in, and therefore we get 1 minus the products of 1 minus. What this suggests is that sometimes we can manipulate these probabilities and compute query answers efficiently in this simple case of tuple-independent probabilistic databases. So a short summary on this simplest of all possible models. The expressive power is very limited. First of all, the possible words you can express is limited to the subsets of what you enumerate. And I insist on that because I will show you other models which are not limited to a subset of a concrete instance. The probability distribution on these possible words is also limited. It's tuple independent. And I haven't shown you, but you can probably guess this, the queries are not closed under application. What you get as a result of a queries are tuples that are correlated, that are dependent. The second formalism I'm going to show you is the most powerful one. And we learned about this from papers by Fuhr, for instance, from this one, Fuhr and Röhrke, 1997. And they call this intentional databases. And we believe this is an important concept in probabilistic databases. The idea is to annotate tuples with event expressions. We start with a set of atomic independent events. We have names for them. These are identifiers. Each event has an independent probability, and we know that. We can store this in a separate table. And then we build event expressions using quantifiers and or negation. And now we play the same game as before. We have a database instance, and every tuple will have an attribute which is an event expression like this one. As you will see, this allows us to model very, very complex correlations. Let me show you an example. Here we have a very simple database, two tuples. You can imagine representing this in a real database. And there are two event expressions over atomic events E1, E2, E3. These event expressions want to say that when this expression is true, then John is in. When this expression is true, then Sue is in. And depending on how these two expressions share common sub-events, there might be interesting correlations between these two tuples. Let me show you the systematic way to go from here to the possible words. The way you have to, what you have to do is you have to enumerate all possible assignments of events. The events can be true or false. 8 possible assignments. And now each of them will result in a certain instance. There are only 4 possible instances, so you probably guessed some of them will be shared. So these are all the possible instances you can build as a subset of I. So these 4 correspond to empty. This is perhaps more interesting. True, false, true will result in John being in. This is true, and the other expression is false. It's not very interesting. What is interesting is that multiple evaluations here may result in the same instance. And this gives you the correlation between tuples. So now we finally have to compute the probabilities. And here they are. This is easy because this is generated by a single combination of events, and this probability is this product. This is generated by 2 combinations of events, so we just add those 2 probabilities. This is the intentional database representation. What's interesting is that you can also go the other way around. You can start with a possible words representation, if you had one, an enumeration of possible words, and convert that, like here, we have 4 instances which I haven't shown you, and you can convert that into an intentional database. I would skip the details here, but you have, but the message is you have so much power in how you construct these events that you can express any possible words, any probability distribution you can express in this way. Obviously, tuple independent databases are just a special case when all these, every tuple has a separate event expression. Then you get a tuple independent database. So, what are intentional databases? They are a very powerful formalism. They are complete. They can express any probabilistic database. But they also look kind of impractical. You have to manipulate those expressions. Yet, we feel they are a very important concept to keep in mind. And that's because you can imagine designing other formalisms, more simpler formalisms, by restricting from this very powerful one, by imposing restrictions. The interaction with queries, well, because it's complete, it better be closed. Anything you can compute is just a possible word, and therefore it's representable as, in terms of event. But it's provably inefficient to compute, as I will show you later. Okay, the third formalism I wanted to show you, kind of here I'm jumping up and down. I started with the simplest one, with the tuple independent, because that's so intuitive. I think that's the first one you would like to see. And I showed you the most complicated one, which is are the intentional databases. Now I'm going to get back to the simpler one and argue that in addition to independent tuples, we may want to have also these joint tuples. This is actually the most popular formalism that people have used in the literature in previous probabilistic database systems. So what they model is either disjointness between 2 tuples, what in this tutorial we denote with double minus, independence, which we denote with 0, or identical events, which we denote with double plus, and no other correlations. This is easy to represent as a restriction of intentional databases. Just introduce, for every event E sub I, split it into shares. These are disjoint shares, EI1, EI2, EI3. So these are kind of events. No 2 of them can happen simultaneously. And they together represent EI. So let me show you an example. One of the applications we discussed was constraint violations in consistent databases. For example, this one is a database of sales. where a certain functional dependency is supposed to hold, that the customer should each customer should have a single address. Unfortunately, it doesn't hold. How do we represent this probabilistically? We would like to say that if two tuples conflict, then we would like to decrease our probability and record the fact that they are mutually exclusive. They can't be at the same time. It's easy to do with these disjoint events. For example, John in Seattle and in Boston would have the same event, but two different shares, E11 and E12, which means these are exclusive events. John in Boston and Houston are also the exclusive events, E12 and E13. So all these three tuples are mutually exclusive. But the first two tuples, John in Seattle, they're the same event, E11. If you think the first tuple is a correct one, then better be the second one too, because, well, then you have decided that John lives in Seattle. But when it comes to Sue, that's a totally different matter. John and Sue have nothing to do with each other. So Sue we model with a totally different event, E21, E22. A second example. Most data probabilistic database systems we have seen in the literature, for instance, that by Barbara and Hector Garcia Molina and PropView by Lakshmanan, they allow you to model probabilities at the attribute level. So for example, they allow you to say something like this. There is a record whose name is John. He works in the toy department, but we are not sure about his bonus. His bonus can be great, good, or fair, and these are the exclusive, the disjoint probabilities for these three values. This is easily modeled with these shares. You just introduce three tuples, and you record the fact that they are disjoint. There are other representations that come from the knowledge representation community that are essentially variations on this idea. Bayesian networks. There is a huge literature on Bayesian networks. What they do is that they give you a very concise representation of a probability distribution of disjoint tuples by exploiting independence between attributes. And I will stop here. If you know what Bayesian networks are, this is the connection. This will help you make the connection to the kind of representations we use in probabilistic databases. They use some more advanced model, probabilistic relational models, that extend Bayesian networks to sets of tuples. And this results in sets of tuples that are disjoint, independent, but also dependent. There are some dependencies. So I don't think the expressive power of the probabilistic relational models from our perspective, from perspective of closure under query, is well understood. But I would emphasize that they were developed primarily for learning, not for query processing. Okay, so a summary on this third formalism. This has been used, and so disjoint and independent tuples appear in most probabilistic databases. It's also an incomplete representation. It's not closed under query application. And it seems to be like a very robust idea. Other models from knowledge representation, they are closely related to it. Okay. So these are essentially the models that have been proposed for probabilistic database systems. Let me show you a completely different kind of model that's actually inspired from random graphs and 0-1 laws. That's actually very useful for reasoning about information disclosure, and we also believe for representing probabilistic databases. And that's based only on statistics. Suppose I have a table employee, And instead of telling you which tuples might be inside and what their probabilities are, I tell you nothing. But I may tell you its cardinality. At least its expected cardinality. I'm telling you there are about 200 employees. So this suggests at least a probability distribution on instances, on the employee instances, for which the expected size of the employee instance is 200. In fact, if you start with this probability distribution, a tuple-independent one, where every tuple has this probability, C, which is this cardinality, divided by the product of the three domain sizes, the number of possible names, number of possible departments, number of possible phones. This gives what's called a binomial distribution, that every tuple has this probability of being in or out. And if you compute the expected size of your table, that's C. So let's assume this distribution for the moment and see what can you do with such a probabilistic database. It's an extreme case. I took out every concrete information. I only kept this information about cardinality. Here is what you can do. You can ask this query. It's like a secret query. This is what the attacker would like to find out. Is Mary working in your database, and does she have this phone number? And I don't care about the department where she works. Well, what is the probability of this query being true? Each tuple that I can obtain by filling out this wildcard has this probability. How many tuples are there like this? How many ways I can fill out this wildcard, which is N2, the number of distinct departments. So the probability of this query is C by N1 and N3, obtained by multiplying this with N2. And when N1 and N3 here are the domain sizes, so this is like 200 by the total number of possible names in the domain times the number of possible phone numbers. It's a very low number. It's like zero. But hold on to it, because now I would like to publish on the website the fact that Mary is in my database and she works in the sales department. And I hope nobody will guess the phone number. Now the adversary can see this, and he can now compute a conditional probability, which is what's the probability of S given V1. That's the quotient of these two probabilities, of probability of S and V1 and of the probability of V1. And I will spare you the math here, but the result is that now the probability is still small, 1/3. You can't guess a phone number if you don't see it. But if in addition, I also want to say that somebody in the sales department has this phone number, and you combine these two facts as an attacker and compute the conditional probability of the secret fact, then bingo, you have, how do you call it, a home run, you hit the jackpot. In this case, the probability turns out to be 1. It's kind of mind-boggling. Why does this happen? But let me forget the math. Let me ask you a question. Suppose I'm giving you an employee table. I'm telling you there are 200 employees. And importantly, the 200 tuples, no, don't think of them as employees with key independent, just 200 triples. There are 200 triples in my database. These 200 triples have been chosen randomly from the domain. And I tell you that there are two triples, perhaps the same, but there is one triple that matches this, Mary in the sales department. And there is a second one that matches this, sales department is this phone number. Let me turn things around. What is the probability that two tuples out of these 200 share the same department? Is it big or is it below? They share the same department.
How many departments are there?
Many. This is like 2 to the power. It's very low. If you assume this independent distribution, that's very low. It's like 1/2. It doesn't show up in these calculations. But it's like 1/2. So therefore, the probability that these two are actually the same department is very high. That they are the same tuple is very high. And therefore, the probability that actually Mary has this phone number is also very high. This is why the limit probability of this secret query is 1. Of course, in real life, we know much more. We know functional dependencies. We may know some extra facts. We would like to put them together with statistics about data. So a summary on this way of thinking about probabilistic databases through statistics. It's expressive. There is no question about its expressive power. This is not a formalist per se, but it's one source of evidence that we would like to use in specifying probabilistic databases. Think of it as being useful when used in combination with other formalism. So I have shown you 4 formalism so far. Actually, only 3 are serious. The first one is not a formalist, but it's more like another twist on defining probabilistic databases. But also, let me show you my wish list. Here is what I would like to do. I would like to be able to specify a probabilistic database like this. I would like to throw everything in. I would like to say, look, the tuple probabilities are these. But I also know that there are not just 3 customers, there are about 24 customers. And I also know that every customer is in a single city, but actually not necessarily in one city. I may have exceptions. So the average number of cities per customer is like 1.2. And I would like to add more stuff. Actually, I should add more stuff here. I would like to also say something about correlations between tuples. So how would you take such specifications and turn them into a probability distribution on instances? We need to get to those possible words in order to have a clean semantics for queries and so on. And the technique is called entropy maximization method. If you haven't heard, and if you're not familiar with this, you might get scared by the term, but it's actually a very simple method. It says, look at any probability distribution on instances that adds up to 1, that satisfies all these constraints, and choose that one that maximizes the entropy. And the good news is that if you really have to do this and work the math, it turns out to be surprisingly simple. So we can turn that into real algorithm to do something about the queries. Yes?
What's the intuition behind that?
The intuition behind?
Wanting to maximize the entropy.
That's a good question. I didn't mention that. What's the intuition behind maximizing the entropy? The intuition is that maximizing the entropy corresponds to assuming likely probabilities when you know nothing else. For example, if you take all your instances and you say nothing about them, and now you look for the probability distribution that maximizes the entropy, that's a uniform distribution in which every instance has the same probability. But now let's suppose I declare that the expected size is 200. And now I look at the entropy maximization. I can't equate probabilities. Of course, those that are around 200 will have a higher probability than those that are huge. If you do the entropy maximization distribution, you get precisely the binomial distribution. And it goes on and on. If you just take this, you say, I want to observe that John is in Seattle with this probability. And I have these 3 probabilities that I want to observe and nothing else. And you compute the entropy maximization distribution. That's exactly the tuple independent probability distribution for this tuple independent extensional database. OK. So let me skip the thoughts about entropy maximization, and let me summarize the formalism. So what have we seen? We have seen essentially three formalisms that have been discussed in the context of probabilistic databases. Many more exist in the field of knowledge representation and machine learning. And the three are the tuple independent model, the very powerful intentional databases, and the variation tuple independent and tuple disjoint model. The intentional databases are complete, but they are complex, as I will show you in the next 10 minutes or so. The tuple independent ones, of course, they are too simple and too restrictive. And the others are like items on a wish list for a powerful specification formalism. Any questions about specification formalism so far?
So I was trying to think back about the five problems that you introduced at the beginning. Okay. And trying to ask myself how I cast it in this world of yours. I guess I'm not super sure.
The five classes of applications?
Yeah. I mean, I want to close the loop and try to understand, okay, those are great motivating things. And Dan said probabilistic database has promise for those. Uh-huh. So what happens? You know, how do I get this P1, P2, P3? What happens? I want to have a deeper understanding. I mean, I think you can't in a tutorial do justice to all five. But even if you take one or a couple and actually work through that, well, you know,
we'd like
what
to
comes
see.
Out, good. What others have done, that gives us an understanding it actually works. Because here it is a little more abstract because I have to assume that I know this probability somehow. Okay, I mean, there is a certain gap here that, you know, as data is getting dumped somewhere, it's very hard to relate from that world to this world. There is a bit of jump. So.
Good point. I only takes two slides to do the closer loop. Good point. Okay, so now fun part, theory. How many people hate theory? Nobody
hates. It all depends how it goes from here. So. You may have more people who hate theory after your presentation.
That's my goal. So I want to show you three snapshots of results. One is, and I hope you are not familiar with none of, we are unfamiliar with each of them. Probability of Boolean expressions, query probabilities, these are connected, and then, as I promised you, the evolution of random graphs. Probability of Boolean expressions. We love Boolean expressions. We know them inside out. Now I give you this simple problem. Here is a Boolean expression. And instead of asking you to tell me if it's true or false, I give you the probabilities of each Boolean variable, and I ask you for the probability of this Boolean expression of being true. How do you do it? Any ideas how to compute this probability? Well, this example is chosen to be very simple. To us, it was a surprise when we got into this. We kind of felt like we don't know some basics here. So what you do in this case, you regroup the variables in a clever way. You group x1 times x3 or x4, and then x2 here, x5, x6. And then you happily observe that these are independent, and then you get to this huge expression, which actually makes a lot of sense when you read it. Okay, so let's come up with a general algorithm. But first, let's try this. And when you try this, you get stuck. There is no way to group them. But still, how would you compute the probability of this Boolean expression? And it turns out that there is a naive way to do this. Actually, I don't know why it took us all so long to conceptualize this. You just enumerate all possible Boolean assignments. You notice where this expression is true. And you compute the probability of that assignment. Here, x1 is false, x2, x3 are true. So this probability is 1 minus p1, p2, p3. Now, these are independent events, so you can simply add them. Is there a mistake?
These are disjointed.
They are disjoint events. I said independent. These are disjoint events, so we can simply add them. What's kind of surprising here is that this was a positive expression. So I would expecting some expression here that where it's obvious that it's positive in P1 or in P2 and whatever. And it's not. You have here terms like 1 minus P1. You had them also before, but they were under double minus, so they were obviously positive. Here it's like not obviously positive. So you think about this, this is exponential, of course. And it turns out that it is inefficient in general. The theorem due to Boolean, 1979, is this. The problem of computing for an arbitrary Boolean expression E, the number of assignments, I should replace this with the number of assignments, which is like the probability when you assume each of the Boolean variables has probability 1/2. This is sharp P complete. What is this complexity class sharp P? NP, of course, is a class of problems of the form, is there a witness? For instance, SAT is a problem which says, is there an assignment that makes this expression true? Sharp P is a class of problem where we want to count, where we say, how many witnesses are there? And sharp SAT is precisely this problem. It asks you to count how many witnesses you have. So here, this should be sharp SAT. What's intriguing about sharp, okay, so if a counting problem were in P time, then the corresponding decision problem is obviously in P time as well. Because, well, you just count and you check if it's greater than zero. But the converse is not true. For example, checking the satisfiability for two CNF is in P time, only three CNF becomes NP hard. But the corresponding counting problem is already sharp P complete. So it's easy to check if there exists one assignment, but it's hard to actually count them. So that was my first little nugget, theoretical nugget. Bottom line, computing the probability of Boolean expressions is sharply complete. And this goes to the essence why query evaluation on probabilistic databases starts by being hard. And this is kind of bad. It's even hard for very simple cases, like 2 DNF. But there is good hope. There are very efficient Monte Carlo simulation algorithms, and I will show you two of them later. The second nugget I want to show you is how to apply this to query complexity. By now, you kind of expect that since Boolean expressions are hard to compute, the queries can't be much simpler. But I will show you that even for very simple queries, the data complexity turns out to be high. So the question I'm going to ask is this. Given a query and a probabilistic database, and I'm going to assume the simplest scenario. This would be a tuple-independent database. Compute the answer to this query, and I'm going to assume the simplest kind of answer, the possible tuples, not the possible answers, just the possible tuples. And let's analyze its complexity. And I will do a short detour on how to evaluate queries over intentional databases and then over tuple-independent databases. Suppose you decide on the intentional representation of databases with events. How can you evaluate queries in this case? It's actually quite straightforward, and this has been described in the work by Fuhr and Röhrke. What you do is you extend every relational operator in a way to manipulate the event expressions. For example, if you have a selection, and this is the incoming stream, and you have a tuple here, V, and this event expression is E, and it satisfies the selection. It just preserves the event expression. If you have a join, and these two tuples join, and they have different event expressions, what you do, you just take their conjunction. If they were correlated, that's OK, because this is a symbolic expression. It takes care of the correlation. If you want to do a projection, which means also duplicate elimination, then what you do, you take all the tuples that project into the same value, and there will be here an expression that is a big disjunction. So if you apply this for a, let's say, for a conjunctive query, what you end up with is, well, you can do this at the very end. You end up with these formulas in conjunctive normal form. And the number of conjuncts can be big because they come from these groups. The number of terms in each conjunct is relatively small. This corresponds to the number of joins. If you have negations or existential quantifiers or universal quantifiers, then you need more complicated expressions with negation. But the problem is we get these results very efficiently, but now we're stuck because we have to compute these expressions. And this is a sharply complete problem. There is another naive way to try to evaluate the queries by manipulating probabilities directly. So let me show you how this works. You just blindly assume independence. If you remember the application wheel that I showed you earlier, this is what it does. And this is what many systems do. They just manipulate probabilities, and they assume independence whenever they see them. So here they multiply them. Here they assume independence, so they compute this value. It's much more efficient. You're not manipulating symbolic expressions, but just numbers. And you get answers which have probabilities. However, it turns out they are not always correct, which is kind of expected because they can't be always correct. So let me show you an example. Let's take this query. We analyzed it before. The join between person and purchase. We want all cities where some customer, we want all cities of customers that purchased gadget. The standard query plan that every engine will deploy for such a simple query is the selection is pushed down, then there is a join, and then a projection with duplicate elimination. Let's see what happens if we compute this query plan according to this naive semantics. Well, we first do the join, which means that we multiply the probabilities. And then we do the projection, which means we compute the 1 minus, should be 1 minus everything here. It's not, it's 1 minuses. This is the wrong result. Because if you remember, everything has started, the Seattle answer should start with P1 times. Theater can only be an answer if the event whose probability is P1 is true. So this expression must be of the form P1 times something. And the problem was here, essentially. These events are no longer independent. So when we do the projection, this doesn't work. Another plan, so this is wrong. Another plan is to do the projection early. We first consolidate all the purchases that John made. You wouldn't do this in a traditional database because this involves duplicate elimination at some point, and then you need to do another duplicate elimination later. But here, what it binds you is that you can consolidate these probabilities for John. This should be John here. And now you can take the Cartesian, the join, and you get the right result. So this is correct. So what this example shows you is that different plans may result in different answers. This is bad. It means that a naive approach to probabilistic databases probably gets stuck at some point. You won't be able to do optimizations. You don't have a clean semantics for your queries, all sorts of problems. It also gives us a false hope that maybe if you try hard, you will always find plans like this. Well, nope. And surprisingly, the query which does not have such a plan is as simple as this one. Let's call it QBAD. It's a Boolean query, and it just joins R with S with T. But it doesn't want to see these variables, X and Y. And for this query, the data complexity is sharply complete. And so you freeze a query, and you study the problem. What's the problem of computing the query answer, which is in this case, since it's a Boolean query, it's just a probability, on an arbitrary extensional database. And that problem is sharply complete. Moreover, it turns out that there is a nice classification, a nice dichotomy of conjunctive queries based on whether they have a P time data complexity, like the extensional query plans that I've shown you earlier, or whether it's sharply complete. So it's either or. And let me not dig here into go here into details. So a summary on data complexity. The extensional query evaluation, the one that just multiplies probabilities and doesn't care what happens, it's very popular. But it doesn't work. People know that it doesn't work, but what can they do? They're waiting for us to come up with better query evaluation techniques. And what's bad is that it depends on the query plan, which is kind of annoying. It goes against what we know and love in databases, where we want to choose what query plan we want. Okay, so the theoretical complexity is sharply complete, and it doesn't go beyond sharply complete, even for more complex queries. This is not surprising. What I think it is surprising is that it's sharply complete even for very, very simple queries. And this is one of the messages that I hope will come through from this tutorial, is that probabilistic databases, they start with a high query complexity. And this is unlike other data models that started from much lower query complexity. And the third theoretical nugget that I wanted to show you is a brief excursion into the world of random graphs. How many people know the theory of random graphs? One person, so somebody who can actually slip my wrist if I say something wrong. So then I hope you find this fascinating. This theory originates with a work by Erdős and René in 1959. And the side branch is a work on a 0-1 loss, which originated with work by Glebsky and was actually known in the Western world only after Fagin published this result in 76. And the story I'm going to tell you is based on the book by it's from a book by Spencer in 2001, where he has it's a good evening read. Here is the setting. Fix a single relation. Think of it as a binary relation, which represents a graph. And we have a domain, 1 to n. These are the possible nodes in the graph. And now consider a probability distribution, which is tuple independent. Every tuple has an independent probability, and all tuples have the same probability. And the same probability, this is why we call it uniform, is P. So this is a setting. You have these numbers, and you randomly pick which edges you insert in the graph. Now, every edge with the same probability. The questions that Erdős and René asked was the following. Given a Boolean property, I'm going to call it a query. It can be an arbitrary property. check what is the probability that this property is true. But it's not interesting to see this on this particular domain. It's interesting to see what happens if the domain is very big. Remember, that was a limit we had when we discussed about information disclosure, when we argued that if the domain is big, then interesting things happen. So it will become more concrete when I show you Fagan's 0-1 law. In this case, every tuple has probability 1/2. Every edge has the same probability of being in or not. So then Fagan proves the following quite incredible result, that for any sentence in first of the logic, you can think of it as a relational, as a query in the relational calculus. You compute this sentence on a random database. It will have some probability. That probability will have a limit when n goes to infinity. And that limit is either 0 or 1. So in some sense, every sentence is almost always true or almost always false. It's a very clear classification of sentences in first order logic. So we wonder what it says to databases. And here is my favorite interpretation. It says that what we are doing is useless because every query is either true or is false. Don't bother answer it. Tell the user that its limit probability is, it's either true or false. You can actually decide whether the limit probability is true or false. What's wrong with this thinking is the particular probabilistic model. If every edge has probability 1/2, and we had so many nodes, n is big, the size of the domain, what is the expected size of the table R? Well, R can have up to n squared edges. And each of them has probability 1/2. So the expected size is like n squared by 2. And this is huge. N is that it's a number of strings you can represent on bar chart of 50. It's a huge number. So this is why this theorem is in a setting which doesn't make it very practical, because it assumes that every database has the same probability, which makes the very huge, unrealistically big databases quite likely. It turns out that the original setting in Erdős and René's random graphs is much more interesting for us, because they look at the case when the edge probability is a function of n. And it will be a small function of n. That's the interesting case. So their main results, they actually had many results, but it's kind of the one you find first when you try to learn about random graphs like we did, is this one. They say that for any monotone property, and this is completely different from first order logic, it can be any property like connectivity, like the existence of Hamiltonian paths, but it has to be monotone. While first order logic can also express non-monotone properties. So for any property on graphs, there exists a threshold for this probability, a threshold T, such that probabilities below this threshold make that property very unlikely, and probabilities over that threshold make that property very likely. So every monotone property eventually is either true or false, and it has a certain threshold which depends on that property where that transition happens. So then they turn things around, and they said, let's make this Pn grow from very slow functions, from functions which are almost zero, to very big functions, like 1/2. 1/2 would be a very big function because it's big independent of n. And try to see this movie of the graph evolving. How can we observe this movie? It's by asking questions about what properties hold and what properties don't hold about the graph. And then we can see this image unfolding. Now, putting my database hat back again, I would argue that sometimes looking at P of N is less instructive than looking at the expected size of the database, which is N squared times this probability. And to me, this is sometimes more meaningful than P of N. So the void. This is when the probability is so. This is like the first chapter in this evolution. The probability is so small that it's less than 1 square. And because it's less than 1 square, the expected size is goes to 0. It's significantly less than n squared by n squared, which is 1. In other words, you're dealing with a database which, with very high probability, is nothing in. So what does it contain with high likelihood? Nothing. It doesn't contain an edge. Fagan's 0-1 law still holds for this case, which was not Fagan's original theorem, but for a very trivial reason. This is not an interesting case. That was the first day. Now on the case day, and k goes from 1, 2, 3 up to infinity. Here p is kind of hard to read what happens here. This is a probability which is essentially between 1 by n squared, which was something we knew and loved, and 1 by n. But between 1 by n squared and 1 by n, we have these intermediate stations, which are some power of n, which are between 1 and 2. They are separated by this k. And the reason why this k is important is because it tells us what the graph contains and what it doesn't. With high probability, the graph contains trees with up to k edges. So the graph looks like a collection of such trees. It will not contain trees with more than k edges. The theory of random graphs is for undirected graphs, so think of these as going in either direction. It will not contain cycles. So on the case day, the graph is a collection of trees with up to k edges, and they are disconnected. And the 0-1 laws still hold. So time flies, and we reach day infinity. When P of n wants to be 1 by n, but it's not like 1 by n to the power 1 by 1 plus 1 by k, for any k, so it's bigger than any such function. What happens here is that the graph will contain all the trees. It's still disconnected, but it will contain all the trees. But it still doesn't contain any cycles, and therefore no other structures more complicated than trees. Now it's still a union of these joint trees. And the 0-1 law still holds. At 1 by n, this is where the math gets very difficult. And some of the major results by Erdős and Rényi, they are around 1 by n. There are two major jumps there, which we don't quite follow. We are database theoreticians, okay? So we have some understanding of what it means. But for our purpose, it's interesting what happens beyond 1 by n. And here, beyond, things evolve up to log n by n. So now that graph contains any tree and any cycle. So think of a graph as a collection of trees and cycles. And these cycles actually, I should have drawn them, they also have some side branches, some side trees that go from them. But it will not contain anything beyond the cycle. It will not contain a cycle plus, how do you call it, a cut. It will not contain two connected cycles. In general, it doesn't contain any subgraph with k nodes and k plus one edges. It only contains all the trees and all the cycles. And there's actually more to that. I will modify the slide. Finally, and not finally, eventually the graph reaches this threshold, log n by n. That's the moment when the graph becomes connected. So now it's connected. What does it contain? It contains every cycle, every tree as before. It still doesn't contain, this is the wrong picture. It should be the picture from previous time. No subgraph with k nodes and k plus one edges. So no connected cycles, no cycles with these chords. But here is something interesting. Every node has degree greater than k for any k. It is still a finite graph. This is a strange logic of random graphs. So what this says is that if you choose your k and you ask what is the probability that a node has degree greater than k? And the answer comes back, it's 1. Okay, then let me try a bigger k. What's the probability that the graph has degree k plus 1? It's still 1. So these nodes, they seem to have infinite degree. And the graph is connected, and it has a 0-1 law. So now it gets interesting. Although this is a domain which is less important, I would argue, for databases, because the size is too big. This should be n to the alpha. So when it's 1 by n to the alpha, where alpha is between 0 and 1, then the graph is connected, it's very rich. But the interesting thing is that the 0-1 laws hold precisely when alpha is irrational. Very mind-boggling. And this is a result by Spencer and Shalah. And they do not hold if alpha is rational. And when alpha is zero, that is the limit case when the probability is constant. And then we are back to Fagan's 0-1 law. So that is the story of random graphs. I should mention random graphs is big. So it's a huge field. It's also very old, dates back from to 59. Bolobash in a book mentions over 700 references. And he said he had difficulties keeping track of all of them. It's also a fascinating theory. You read about these evolutions of random graphs. You see these trees growing from the cycles. It's kind of beautiful. I would like to see a movie on this topic. I would argue that Fagan's 0-1 law, despite its beauty, uses an impractical probabilistic model. It forces us to think that the database is huge, which is not true. The database is finite, and the domain is huge. And that setting leads you to probability distributions like this. And my favorite is when alpha is 2, because that results in a fixed size of the database. And these settings have been studied in terms of the 0-1 laws by Spencer and Shalah and by Lynch. Especially Lynch has many, many results here. Okay, and this is the end of the theoretical part. Any questions?
Why did you make us read random graphs?
Yes. Why do I make you listen to random graphs?
We lost the poor sigmoid attendee.
I lost it?
We lost the poor sigmoid attendee.
Okay. Okay.
Well, it's pretty, and the results are very neat. But what does it have to do with the concerns you started out with? So I'm trying to pull you back to the first five problems you did. Mm-hmm. And so what from this can I take away and solve any of those?
I can speculate.
Speculate, that's right.
It's about computing probabilities when you don't know the possible tuples that you have in the database. You only have statistics about the database. if I just give you the cardinality of the database and tell you nothing else, this corresponds to one of the settings in this random graphs, when the tuple probability is 1 by n squared. It's actually c by n squared.
So let's see, what is the context? I don't know any entries in the database at all, and I have a query. Is that the model?
Right.
And what I expect as an answer.
Right. And then you turn things around, you ask a conditional probability. Suppose I know this and that about the database, and I have a query. What is now the
answer? But the random graph model is equal probability in all edges, right? But your probabilistic database is much, the model that you discussed earlier is much richer than
you have individual.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. So the random graphs by themselves will not give us any results that we can just plug in. But I think what I believe we need is to be able to reason about statistics, to be able to say declare statistics about the data, and then magically comes back some query answers or some.
Okay, so my sense is that I don't know how well you're doing in time. You have a better sense than I do, but that's an area in which for Bors it may be a great talk. For sigma, the connection is pretty weak with the rest of the stuff, so that you can shorten that part for sure.
The random graph, okay.
This is pretty.
I could also take it out.
Yeah, well, I'm not going to suggest that. It's something good to make people aware, but on the other hand, you probably can compress it a lot more and tell them this field exists and here is a free model. Give the more general model.
Yeah, no, I'm aware. It's kind of a long shot. For the Sigmod audience. Okay, so the fifth part, algorithm and implementation techniques. And again, here we have three snapshots of techniques completely unrelated that together will give you some sense of hope that we can evaluate queries efficiently on probabilistic databases. And the first is an old theoretical result on a Monte Carlo simulation. Remember the problem that we have. Given a Boolean expression, we want to compute its probability, and this is sharply complete. But there is a very naive method that's based on simulation that works pretty well in practice, and it says like this. Throw a dart. Choose randomly three values, which are either 0 or 1. How do you choose them? With what probability? Precisely with the probabilities for x1, x2, x3, which are given. And now check. If the expression turned out to be true, then count it. If it turned out to be false, don't count it. And repeat this. Repeat this many times. When you decide you have tried enough, then compute the probability, the estimated probability, to be the number of hits by the total number of iterations that you have done, the total number of trials. And the questions to ask about such a simulation algorithm is how well are you doing? How close are you to the real probability? Obviously, the answer can't be deterministic. The answer has to be probabilistic. So the resulting formula is kind of scary because it's hard to read. But it actually says something very intuitive. We have to read the second line here. It says this, the probability that our estimation differs from the real value by more than epsilon, this probability is less than delta. What are epsilon and delta? I can choose them however I want, but once I choose epsilon and delta, I need to run this many times, namely so many times. This theorem is called the 0-1 estimator theorem. It seems to be a standard theorem in statistics. This term is not of great interest to us. We have to live with it. Here is where we are concerned. The number of iterations that we have to run is proportional to 1 by the probability of the event. The intuition is the following. This is a space of all possible assignments to x1, x2, x3. this is a space whose probability we want to estimate. We're essentially throwing darts here. And if this surface, if this area is small, then we need to throw a lot of darts until we hit it. Sometimes this is not a concern. And we really don't know if it is a concern or not in probabilistic databases. You could argue that users are interested in the top answers whose probability is high to start with. And then that wouldn't be a concern. For theoreticians, this definitely was a concern because this term is exponential in the size of the original problem. So they turn things around and they... So this works for any Boolean expression, but it's not a p-time algorithm. Karp, Luby, and Madras propose this improved Monte Carlo algorithm, which I'm going to describe very briefly to show you the feeling of why it's so simple, without explaining why it works. What they say is that instead of choosing directly these values, choose first which clause you want to satisfy. Choose randomly which clause Ci you want to satisfy. You choose among these m clauses with a probability which is proportional to the probability of that clause. Since the clause is just a product, this probability is easy to compute. The clause is, let me go back here for a moment. It's easy to compute this probability of x1, x3. It's just their product. What's difficult is to compute the probability of this disjunction. That's our task. So computing the probability of an individual clause is simple. And we need to choose clause I, Ci, with a probability which is proportional to Ci. We normalize the sum of all these probabilities. And then we choose the variables in the second step. And here we freeze the variables that have to be true or false according to Ci. It might have negations, so some of them have to be false. Others that occur non-negated have to be true. And for the rest, we randomly choose them in 0 or 1. This guarantees that Ci will be 1. And now comes the mind-boggling trick in this algorithm. And then we check that this turns out to be, that this happens to be the first clause in this order, which is true. No previous clause is true. Essentially, when there is an overlap, we decided that every point that belongs to many sets, we make it to belong to just the first set and not to the others. And that's what we count, and that's what we return. And we need to normalize here by 1 by s, which I kind of forgot. And with this magic trick, the term that we had here becomes 1 by m, which is the number of clauses. This algorithm is running in polynomial time. But it only works for expressions that are in DNF. So a summary. Since evaluating Boolean expressions and queries over probabilistic databases is sharply hard, we expect that simulation will play a role. There is a pretty rich literature on simulation algorithms. The ones we discussed are well-known ones, but others exist. There exists a class of algorithms called Monte Carlo Markov chain algorithm, which we don't know how important they are for probabilistic databases. The main message is there is a rich set of techniques that is relevant to probabilistic databases in the simulation world. The second algorithm I want to discuss is actually quite well known in the database community. How many people here have heard about no Fagan's threshold algorithm? Okay, about half. I wonder how many people will know this in this sigmod room. I will ask the same question. So here the goal is the following. We want to evaluate multiple similarity predicates on multiple attributes of the same table. So we have, for instance, the table house, And we have three similarity predicates on bedrooms, style, and district. Suppose that we have some magic, some indexes or something, that can return to us all the houses sorted by the similarity score with respect to bedrooms. So there will be like a procedure that gives us house after house in decreasing order of their bedroom score. There's a separate procedure that gives us the houses sorted by style, and the third one that gives us houses sorted by district. We also have a function that combines these scores. Think of it as plus, or perhaps multiplication, or some function that combines the scores into a total score. The goal is to read these lists, but not too much, in order to get the guaranteed top k answers to this query. And this is what Fagan's algorithm does. You will get it immediately if you examine this snapshot here. The first list is a sorted list of houses by bedroom. H32 is the best match with score X1. Then this house with score X2, the scores are in decreasing order. This is the list of houses sorted by style and the set of houses sorted by district. And up to a point, we have advanced so far in this list, and we stop here. So we need to read the next element in each list. Let's examine the global scores of what we have seen so far. One of the houses is H555. This occurs in three places. So we have all three scores. That's a score here. On this axis, the score of H555 is F of X2 and Y1, Z3. It happens to fall here. That was an easy case. Let's examine H007. Now, H007, we have seen two scores, but not the Y score. That's missing. But the important observation here is that Y has to be between 0 and Y3. 0 is like the upper bound. All the scores are greater than 0. But why does it have to be less than Y3? And that's because since H07 hasn't appeared yet in this list, when it will appear, its score must be less than Y3, the last score we saw here. We can do the same kind of reasoning for the other houses. Sometimes we have two missing scores, and then we just replace them with the minimum and maximums, and we get an interval, a range. And these ranges, they may be overlapping. Sometimes they are points. And we just keep track of these uncertain ranges that we see. One important object that we need to track is the next house, the next best house that can come. And that, I don't know here with H question mark, its score is completely undetermined, but it's one kind of score that we have to keep in mind because it can overlap with the other intervals. Its maximum can be bigger than somebody else's minimum. So this is what the algorithm does. At each step, it advances in one of these lists. It actually does round robin. And whenever it advances, it updates this kind of data structure by decreasing the intervals as it learns more scores or introducing new intervals as it discovers new objects. Until when? When does it stop? And the termination condition is very nice and very elegant. It stops when there is when it can draw a line which clearly separates the top k objects from all the others. Then it knows that no matter what else it will discover, these objects will definitely be the top k ones. Okay, so a summary on the threshold algorithm. It's a simple, intuitive, powerful. It's a memorable, it's a really memorable algorithm. The paper discusses many variations. the variation that we had on the slides is called the non-random axis variation. There are others, an approximation one, one which and one which has random axes. There have been extensions and follow-ups since the original paper. One uses probabilistic methods to better estimate those bounds. You can be more aggressive about the bounds and shrink them better if you make some probabilistic estimates on what kind of scores you're going to expect. And there is an extension to a distributed environment.
So, two comments. One is, as Fagan himself recognizes that this algorithm itself was co-discovered by Nepal and Ramakrishnan, so you might like to cite that, which is the earliest, before Fagan actually.
Okay.
So that's one thing. The second thing is that it wasn't obvious why you discussed it. What's the importance of, I mean, it's a great elegant algorithm. But what does it have to do with probabilistic derivatives?
Okay. Yeah, it's joint.
Yeah. It's great. I mean, I like it a lot and everyone likes it, but why discuss this? I mean.
Yeah. My concern is also how many people in the room will know it.
I mean, but the question is that why does it have a particular place in probabilistic derivatives?
Yeah, it has, because it's about, the assumption, there is an assumption that in probabilistic databases you probably care about the top key answers.
Well, but Fagan's algorithm has nothing to do with probabilistic data. I can use it in a fairly deterministic order where I know precisely top K, the definition of top K in SQL is precise, right? It's a top K by a certain function which is well specified.
Yes.
So as long as a function is monotone, I can use the TA algorithm without any problem whatsoever. Right? So it has nothing to do with probabilistic databases per se. It is a useful technique to evaluate any top-k query
right.
in classical sense.
Yeah. But I don't see, why do you say it doesn't have to do, you can apply it to probabilistic databases.
Well, I mean, but to that same extent, I can refer to almost any joint algorithm and say it is useful for probabilistic. I mean, I want to know the special connection it has.
Okay.
With probabilistic aspect of it. That was not obvious to me. It's certainly applicable in the same way a join algorithm is applicable. But I didn't see the special connection.
I don't think there is any other beyond
that.
Okay, and the third snapshot is on how to use indexes to compute similarity predicates. So this is taken from a paper by Gravano. And the problem is to compute similarity joints between two tables. Remember, that is exactly the same setting. We have two tables. How do we compute similarity joints between them? So normally, you would like to have here a probabilistic score. Now imagine that you have a probabilistic score and the user is interested only in the top k answers. And you're somehow you're able to convert this information that the user is interested in only the top k answers into a threshold for the similarity score here. So then what you need to do from this query is to find all pairs for which all pairs of records for which A and B have a similarity which is greater than some threshold. And with this in mind, I'm going to simplify it. I'm going to look at the case when A and B have at least K qugrams in common, which is even a little bit simpler than what they consider in the paper. So that's the setting. Find all pairs of records which have at least K qugrams in common. Now, what are qugrams? I mentioned them earlier. Qugrams are one of the techniques by which you can compute similarities between strings. Here is a string, John Smith. Let me show you it's three grams. These are all sequences of three characters that you can obtain from John Smith. Sharp means, of course, before the beginning of the string. Here are all the strings of three characters. It's quite obvious. So now given two strings, I want to decide if they have at least k qgrams in common. One solution is obvious. You just write a user-defined function in SQL. And now you run this query, which computes a Cartesian product between R and S. And for each pair of records, just count the number of common qgrams, checks if it's greater than k. And that's, of course, not a very appealing solution. What the paper proposes is to use a very intuitive index, which can speed up that query. The index works like this. It's an index which associates to each key the set of qgrams in that table. For example, if this record has an attribute John Smith, then it will generate many qgrams, and all these qgrams will be stored in this table here with the same key. This would be a foreign key into R. OK, so now let's see how this works. So we had the original query that was looking for all pairs RS that have at least k qgrams in common. We have an index on these qgrams from R.A. We have another index on the qgrams from S.B. And the transform query looks quite big, but it's actually quite natural. Here's what it does. It looks in R and in S and in the corresponding qgrams, makes sure that they join on the right keys. And then it groups by the keys. So it only wants to talk about a single object in R and a single object in S. And in this join, yep, it's here. The qgram has to be the same. And now the count just counts the number of common qgrams. It's one of the fascinating parts of SQL. It's one of my favorite exam questions. When I'm really pissed off the students that they're going to give me a poor evaluation, and I give them a query like that, if I can predict what kind of evaluation I'm going to get. Count the number of common words in two documents in SQL. And they have a hard time transforming that into a count without a subquery. I take points off if they use the subquery. So the way to do this is simple. You group by these keys, and you count how many things you have in the group. And that gives you exactly the number of common qgrams. Because here we ensured that we are counting the same qgram. OK, so that was the last technique I wanted to show you. So summary of part four. I still believe that there are a wide, maybe I didn't quite convince you, but I still believe there is a wide range of disparate techniques that can be used to implement efficient probabilistic database systems. It's not a complete list, but there is a class of simulation algorithm, Monte Carlo simulation, also this more mysterious Monte Carlo Markov chain algorithm. There are ways in which you can combine scores like for a probabilistic join and efficiently compute the top k answers. And there are engineering techniques that allow you to use indexes on the similarity predicates in order to, again, find the top answers efficiently. What's needed is a unified framework for putting these together. Any questions about this part, other than the ones that have been already asked?
So when you say top k evaluation, do you mean possible tuples? Answers. I mean, the semantics where you return the possible tuples with probabilities. Do you want the top k tuples with the best k probabilities?
Yes. I didn't make this explicit enough.
Yeah. Once that you make it explicit before the TA algorithm, maybe that can be used for the join.
Yeah. I agree. I didn't make that explicit enough. Thank you. But that's the idea. In probabilistic databases, we don't want all the answers. We get all the answers in the universe if we want them all, because they will have very low probability. We want the top k.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so some words about conclusions. There are two parts in this tutorial. One is for the need of having a probabilistic databases, and that is motivated by applications of imprecisions in data. There is a wide variety of specialized solutions for various types of imprecise data. What we believe is the case is that the probabilistic database could provide a uniform framework. However, probabilistic databases are not easy. They will be complex. They require for complexity. What about probabilistic databases themselves? The semantics is amazingly simple. The possible word semantics is very simple, and under this semantics, every query, as long as it's a query with sets, has a well-defined semantics. What is missing is a general universally accepted specification formalism. There are specification formalisms out there that have been used. They do not have all the features that we'd like to see in order to represent all types of imprecisions. Also, what's needed are efficient query processing techniques. So let me try to finish this tutorial by defining three challenges. And they're kind of expected. I just want to name them. The first challenge is find a good specification framework. And the major challenge here is a trade-off between expressibility, how powerful this framework is, and destructibility. Clearly, we want to have independent tuples. We want to have disjoint tuples. But I think we need more than that. We need to be able to express tuple correlations. And we need to be able to talk about other tuples that might be in the database and whose attributes are completely unknown to us, like when we talk about cardinality constraints. There is some preliminary work about this. It's preliminary.
So where did that reference that you had, Dan, where is it from?
It's a technical report on their website, which I happen to know because of a comment. Okay, I'm not very sure that I should keep. I'm still debating. The second challenge is query evaluation. And this has, of course, two facets for the theoreticians in the room and for the assistance people in the room. The theoreticians, they need to solve this problem. What is a picture of the query complexity? And there is a slight tweak here. In the past, the query complexity was a function of the query language. You take restrictions or extensions, and you get a different complexity characterizations of a query language. Now we have a double matrix and a two-dimensional matrix because we have both a query language and we will have the specification language, whatever that might be. By the way, there is also an interesting question how to characterize the various expressive power of specification languages. Now, these complexities are almost certain going to be sharply complete. But what is interesting is to characterize the complexity of the approximation problem for these queries. And that's entirely novel. The database theoretical community is not a big fan of approximation algorithms. For the systems community, the major challenge is to come up with efficient evaluation techniques. There are disparate techniques, but they do require a uniform framework. And what I think is going to be the make or break problem for probabilistic databases is how smoothly a system can integrate simulation techniques in its framework. Will the simulation be done on the client side or server side? It's a question for academic research projects like what we're doing at the University of Washington. Because I suppose real system will implement this on the server side. Another question is how do we schedule simulation steps? This is where we actually put our money. When we have multiple possible answers into your query, each of them requires a separate simulation, and you're looking for the top K. Now you have an interesting problem. how do you schedule these simulation steps between these toppers to quickly discover the top k and not waste your simulation money on the loser toppers? Can you push simulation steps in the relational operators? There is a simple idea you can deploy. Originally, atomic events correspond to tuples. So you could imagine doing a first tup over every table, flip a coin, and decide on a bit, which is 0 or 1 for every tuple. But you can do this 32 times, or 64 times. So now you have a bit vector for every tuple. So now you can implement all the relational operators. You can re-implement them, or you can even express it in SQL, to manipulate bit vectors. And you have almost for free a simulation of 64. You have a query that simulates for you 64 simulation steps. Can this be made practical? Can you push simulation steps in the relational operators? Another observation is that sometimes some queries admit very efficient extensional plans. You don't have to do any simulation. You just manipulate probabilities. When you have a complex query, how do you chop it off into fragments that can be evaluated extensionally and fragments that require simulation? Finally, top k pruning. The user is interested in the top k query answers. And now you have a complex probabilistic, you have a complex query plan that computes your probabilistic answer. How can you push down these probabilistic thresholds to the leaves to apply index techniques like the Q-gram indexes? How do you decide on that k in the Q-gram, the threshold? And the third challenge, which is perhaps less obvious, but I think it's going to be a pretty difficult one, is I argued that imprecisions should be modeled as probabilities. But it's not obvious how to do this. You need to put a number between 0 and 1 to every piece of uncertainty in your data. And it's not clear how to do it. We had a hard time converting similarity scores into probabilities. You can choose formulas, and it's not clear which one of them is the right one. When it comes to assigning probabilities to constraint violations, same problem. There are ad hoc choices. What is a principled way to do this? And finally, how do we evaluate such mappings? I think we need some benchmarks, some good benchmarks for evaluating probabilistic queries. And with this, I will stop here, and we'll take your questions. Yes?
I thought about group by and how it fits in your framework.
I didn't talk about group by. So the story with group by is as follows. You can blindly apply to it as the same elegant definition. But what this means is that it will take every possible word, apply the group by operator, and now you wonder what tuples do you get in the answer. Another way to do it is to blindly compute the expected value of your group by operator. This is much more practical. It doesn't quite match with the more elegant definition using possible words. What we plan to implement is this expected value. But for example, so there is a JCM paper in 2005 by V.S. Subrahmanyan, and I forgot the other two authors. They use a possible word semantics for group I. That's it's called query evaluation and probabilistic databases. It's about evaluating group I operators on a probabilistic database. And they do use the possible word semantics with, how should I put it, non-probabilistic means to compute probabilities with what they call strategies that get around tuple correlations. So it's a strange mixture of a very rigid and formal possible word semantics with a much more lax way of computing probabilities. Does this answer your question?
There seems to be a difference between group by and distinct, right? Distinct,
you get a subset of the previous thing. Whereas in group by, all possible aggregations are with zero. If you answer the expected value, of course, it's all that problem. But I'm just curious. I guess I should just read that JSM paper. But I don't know what do they return? Do they return all possible aggregates?
Yeah. They return all possible. Yeah. Which could be a very large number, yeah. And they prove it's a polynomial time in the size of the output. So, okay, so I got very good input from you. Thank you very much. I was hoping I'm done. I'm not done.
Thanks very much, Dave.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.